Let us pray. Most holy and loving God, be with us in the power of your Holy Spirit. And as you guide the thoughts of my heart and the words that you've placed in my mouth to share with friends all over who are connecting with this opportunity of noonday worship, that the journey will lead us to a deeper understanding of your love ethic and our need to follow where you are leading us to the joys of what it truly means to experience the life, the abundant life that you have died so that we might experience one day, knowing that we can envision some portion of that love if we just listen to your voice and try our very best to do what you have commanded. So please be in my mouth and in my speaking, my ears and in my listening, discerning your truth in my heart and the love that comes from this message in honor and glory of you, and the deep-seated desire to live into that love relationship with all of my peers and the human race that I am a part of. For your love is great, and your mercy is great, and our precious lives belongs to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, and I call you friends, because Jesus said to his disciples in John 15, once you related to me as servants, but now you are no longer servants, but I've now exalted you to be friends because I'm sharing all that my Father has given me to share with you. That's a powerful statement for God, the incarnate God, to call us friends. And it's a wonderful model for us to really live into as people of God. As I thought about the message for today, practicing truth, God's truth, and to look at rooted in relationship. When the pandemic began, as I did with the standing committee, I did with the Church of the Holy Spirit, I said, let us gather together and we are going to start to begin this journey wherever it leads together in prayer. And I challenged the church to get up at 6 a.m. in the morning and to join me in prayer 6 days a week. And we are still praying for peace and for all sorts of conditions for healing. And they have steadfastly continued together. We have learned and grown together and have journeyed together to a deeper relationship with God and one another. And this is only possible because of God who created us in love. When two people love each other and give birth to a child, the child becomes an expression of their love for one another. I'm sure for those who have children, that may be true. I don't have any children. But that's what I have heard shared until they become an adult or maybe teenagers. Then, you know, there's a challenge of how we continue to understand that love. But more importantly, when God created us, God conceived every aspect of our being in love and with a desire for us to share the love of the Trinity with us. The revelation of the Trinity is that God is love, the Godhead, and there's unity in the Trinity. That's a given reality of the interrelatedness of the unity of the Trinity, that God wants us to have some idea, as he created us, to have some experience of what it means to live in relationship, in loving relationship with one another. And to have someone idea how in that love we can achieve unity. And it's the best way to achieve unity, grounded in love. And so as I thought about that, truly, all of what God wants from us must be grounded in the foundation of love. The love is the soil from which we grow into something beautiful that God is creating out of a loving relationship that begins in him, flows through us, and we cross-fertilize it with each other. That's a beautiful image of God's love, permeating through all of us, not a source of love that comes from anyone else but God. Why do we say God is love? Rooted in relationship means rooted in love. Relationship has to do with our connection with one another. And so we hear Jesus saying in John 15, verse 9, as the Father has loved me, in that Trinitarian understanding of the experience of love, so have I loved you. We cannot imagine the infinite depth of the Father's love for his only son. His only son. The way the Father has loved his only son, Jesus is saying, I have loved me, you. That's an amazing, meditate on that statement. I imagine if Jesus were to have a different point of view from the Father accepts his son's point of view. They're always in unity with one another. The Son would obey the Father out of love because of the goodness of the Father's love. It is such a beautiful vision of freedom of choice, love, and obedience. The gospel speaks of the interrelationship among Father, Son, and the disciples. And Jesus prayed that the disciples may be one, as he and the Father are one, in his high priestly prayer, shortly before his death. That love of Jesus speaks, its roots run deep in the eternal heart of God. How fortunate that we are to be born out of such love. We are born out of the eternal heart of God. Let us stop and meditate on the truth, because God is truth, of that revelation to us. It feels like that is what God wanted humans to experience when he created us with freedom of choice and with the various gifts, talents that would allow us to fulfill our purpose for which we were created, so that we can live in joy and a sense of contentment. This joy and happiness has to be lived out if we are to experience the joy that God is giving us in relationship with God and one another. And his creation, he has trusted us to take care of the world. There's a degree of trust that love brings forth. That is why he made us stewards of his creation. God also has determined our value. None of us was born with any material possessions, and we take no material possessions with us when we die. By so doing, God is giving us this truth that before Him we are all created equal and have equal value. Now, I did an exercise that is part of the rooted in relationship exercise. I had a bottle of water. Can I walk and take it? And I discovered something about myself as I talked about love. I looked at this water. It's light, it's easy to carry. It's made of plastic. It has water. It has a round, small top that allows me to drink from the bottle. But the bottle contains something essential for my existence. Without water, I cease to exist. We all need water. And so, because of that, this water, this bottle is valuable to me. But there's such an abundance of this. How much do we value this? How much of this do we throw away and not use?
And then what I discovered, though, but when I was through with drinking the water, I was tempted to throw the bottle away. It had no more usefulness for me. And then I remembered, we can recycle the bottle and it can be used again. So then the amazing truth, aha, this is the way we treat people. When they are no longer that valuable to us, we are willing to discard them. We treat them not with the importance and value that God gives them. But why do we have the poor? Because they're no longer important to us. And they don't experience the equal availability and access to so many things that's available in our society. And so this small experience heightened my awareness of how we devalue people. And sometimes people are devalued to the extent that things that we create are more important, are more valuable than people. But God does not do that. God does not change. He created us with a value, and that's permanent. Regardless of race, color, or sexual orientation, or whatever, we are God's children, and God does not discriminate. And that is truth about relationship that God wants us to model in relationship to each other. But it's a conscious choice that we have made not to do that. And that is something that we have to meditate on. If we know who God is in our personal lives, and Jesus is saying, as the Father has loved me, I love you. Listen to me. And the Father has said, listen to me. This is how, if you love me, and I've called you friends, not only friends, you have become my brothers and sisters. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. This is how I want you to live. In unity and peace, reflecting the Trinitarian life of unity and love, as much as you are able to be. And I will be with you always. So the truth is, brothers and sisters, that we devalue each other. We set up structures in our world that does not affirm what God wants us to live, the way God wants us to live. We do have alternate realities, that is true. There's a reality of the truth of God, and there is the reality that we create that we want to benefit us. And so we have lived in that way for so many centuries, but have not identified it. And now through this time of reflection and change in our society, we're beginning to see that there's some truth to that. Relationship is at the heart of creation. And so what's important to God is that, do we love God and do we love our neighbor and Jesus as ourselves? And Jesus raises the barrier. Do we love each other as he loves us? He raises it for those of us who believe and have accepted him as our Savior. As that comment relates to the structures in our society, how do we develop economic, political, and social structures that is designed to care for the needs of all of God's people? We have a choice. We can do that because God, who created us, says we can do that, not by ourselves, but with inspiration and guidance from him. He will lead us to develop economic and social structures that will create an environment of love and care. It is possible. Why is it possible? Because God is love. And God is who says he can make it possible if we trust him. Do we take him at his word or do we take him seriously? But we have not structured society to have that kind of outcome. We have inequities. And we perpetuate those inequities. And the victims who are part of that, we all have some story about how we have been hurt, either politically, socially, or economically, by the way that we have designed our world. We have all had our pain. We have all had our disappointments. We have all been perpetuators of those very pain. I have hurt people, you have hurt people, and others have hurt us. It's a circular reality about our lives. But these policies are implemented by people. How we are formed and our consciousness can determine how we live out these realities in our economic, social structures. And God says he wants us to experience and live into that agape love. Agape love is a choice. God chose to love us. We can choose individually, regardless of what the message of society tells us. We can choose to care about our brothers and sisters regardless of what race or color or whatever situation there is. We can choose. It's a choice. Love is a choice. We can choose to be our brothers and sisters' keeper. We can choose that because God says that we can choose that. And God says he has created us in love and he wants us to live. God wants us, through Jesus, his son, has revealed that, to live a life of loving relationship with one another. And I know we say it's impossible. We have all these different inequities, but it's not impossible. What do we say? Nothing is what? Impossible with God. All we have to do is trust God's goodness. And we have to make an individual choice. Don't depend on anyone else. It begins with us. We must be the change, and you've heard that we need to see. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us what love looks like. Brothers and sisters, friends, love does not hurt. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. This Lenten season is about truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres, and love never fails. And Paul ends, the greatest of these, love, faith, hope, and charity, the greatest of these is love. Brothers and sisters, love is the foundation. God wants it to be the foundation of our lives. And so the truth is, he wants us to bear fruit. Nothing that we bear is fruitful if it's not motivated by love. No matter how successful we are at achieving it, it is not fruitful except the motivation is from love. In relation to what God is sharing with us. So if we are successful by hurting others and we acquire all that we want to acquire and achieve all our goals, but we end up oppressing and hurting others, it is not fruitful. Fruitful means it must be in accordance with the will of God and grounded in love. So whatever we are successful in achieving in society, it is not fruitful in the name of God unless it's grounded in love. And if it's not grounded in love, it's unfruitful, even though it appears fruitful. So we can look around, we see buildings. How many people in the history of our nation has been killed or enslaved to build buildings? Is that fruitful, even though we use it and occupy it in the name of God? No, it's not fruitful according to God. How many lives have been destroyed? How many ways we have hurt and rejected each other? It is not fruitful. Fruitfulness has to do with love. And anything other than that may benefit us, but it doesn't mean it's bearing fruit. It's barren. A barren tree can look beautiful, but it's barren. It has no fruit. We can make a lot. We can nurture it and give it all the attention we need and put the soil and do everything we want, but it does not mean it will bear fruit. It will still bear fruit that is dark, and that's not healthy food. Right now, the war that we are experiencing in Ukraine, that decision to destroy the lives of all those innocent people, regardless of what is happening in politics, God does not pay politics. God knows about his children. We name something politics in order to not face truly what we're doing, I think. But look at all the destruction of lives, innocent children. That cannot be a fruit. And the president, he has decided to stand firm and not leave his people, because he cares about what happens to his people. That bears fruit. Recently, Dr. Paul Farmer, whose life was celebrated just on Saturday, I think, a physician who is in the health field to care for those who are most destitute in the world, all over the world. How was he formed? How are we forming our children? Are we forming our children to love and to care about people? Or are we forming them to be selfish and to just care about what they need or what they want or to be entitled? How are we forming? Certainly, the people that was part of his life and who whatever, he grew up to a person who cared about those who are most destitute. And we all share in the formation of our children, of other people's children. We all share It takes the village, no matter how imperfect we are, to form. We are formed by our environment. So he was formed by that. And I am impressed by such a person who did not limit his ministry to just helping people who need medical care. He wanted the poor to have excellent quality care, which the reality is, if you go into poor neighborhoods, the quality is not there. The care is there, but not the quality of care. It varies. But he was concerned that even the poor should have the same quality of care. And I do believe that if anything is funded by the government, the same quality of care should be given to everyone. If you have the money, then you go to a private situation. And when he tended to the people, his clients, if he discovered they needed transportation because they couldn't, he'd figure a way to go to their home to provide the service or give them transportation. That's love. See, whatever they needed, he tried to provide it. So he does not just looking at their health situation, but it's a holistic approach to caring. That's the kind of love that wants us to live in. That's relational. He could identify with his people. So this is what I want to say. Who are the people in your life? They don't have to be famous. Martin Luther King is one who says, everyone should, he advocated for equality. He saw the diversity of the human race, and he said, this is the vision of God, that we all live in unity and peace with one another. It's the vision of God that Martin Luther King, saw and shared with us. The need for equality and respect the dignity of all of us. We said that in our baptismal covenant. So brothers and sisters, friends, God has called us into a journey of deepening our understanding of what true love is in relation to God and relation to one another. And nothing is fruitful unless love is the foundation of all of it according to God. And that is who Jesus is. He died for all of us. His love was made real when he decided to die for all of us. He chose to die for all of us. It's a choice that Jesus made. This is the best example of what it means to love. What greater love do I have but to put down my life for my friends? So, nothing matters. I live in a world where there's so many things that are distracting, beautiful, but without love, it is what? Nothing. Without love, that is my conclusion. Love is the vitamin. It is the heartstrong of life. It is the foundation of who we are. It is who God has created us to be. An enemy has come and messed it up, but we don't have to give in. We have a choice with God's help. We can overcome, and we do it together. So in conclusion, love. Don't stop being kinder, kind words to one another. It's simple. You don't have to be famous. Who are the people who have been part of your formation that taught you the kind words, the way of living, the truth, how to pursue life in a way that with integrity? Who are those people? Those are the angels that God has sent us to teach us how to love so that we might together continue to build a better world. Love does not destroy. Love builds. Whenever there is destruction, do not call it love. It is not. Love heals. Love builds. Love values us in a way that nothing else values us. God values each of us. That's our value. God is love.
so are you. Amen.